Welcome to Care Coordination and Interoperable Health IT Systems, Implementing Health Interoperability, Lecture B. This unit will cover the following learning objectives. 1. Identify major tasks required to implement interoperability. 2. Explain why interoperability implementation projects are needed. 3. Define and discuss each phase of the interoperability implementation lifecycle. 4. Describe how to apply each phase of the interoperability implementation lifecycle to simple interoperability implementation problems. And 5. List types of production issues with interoperability and identify and describe support strategies. This lecture continues on with the healthcare interoperability implementation lifecycle. It discusses the second step, the analyze phase. The second step in the healthcare interoperability implementation lifecycle is the analyze phase. This is the step in which the problem to be solved is fully clarified and analyzed, gaps are determined, and requirements are documented. It is important to determine the requirements of your interoperability project. First, you need to understand what the customer wants. The customer could be executive leadership, clinicians, frontline staff, and others. You then need to do an environmental scan and determine what the customer already has in place in terms of systems, policies, and manual processes. Finally, you need to determine what capabilities could potentially be utilized in solving the problem. Are there vendor solutions? Are customizations of current systems possible? Is the customer's workflow changeable? The first part of requirements gathering is understanding the problem. This means listening to the users and discovering the true problems to be solved. It is not enough to ask the user what they want, since they do not understand all of the possibilities or limitations. It is not enough for the technicians to assume they know what the user wants because they do not understand the workflow. Collaboration and teamwork are critical. Department walkthroughs are very helpful. This is when a business analyst goes to the work sites to talk to end users and observes and documents end user workflow. This method is often referred to as, quote, go to the Gemba, unquote, and is an important part of the Toyota way, a method for improving quality. Also, rapid prototyping is also useful. Instead of going through a long development cycle where the user must wait to see results far into the process, mock-ups and/or prototypes are created early on to allow the user to visualize the solution. Or the problem is broken into many small problems, with the most urgent one solved quickly and first. This provides immediate user feedback. This method is referred to as the agile method of project development. Once you have an understanding of what the user wants, it is important to compare what the user currently has in place to what is being asked for and determine the gaps that need to be filled. Also, it is key to understand the interoperability capabilities of the systems to be connected. As you can see, the analysis phase is when the investigative work is done to fully scope the problem. A traditional interoperability problem is that the interoperability capabilities of two systems do not fit together seamlessly. Instead, there are differences in the capabilities, leading to gaps in achieving interoperability. The detailed work of comparing, sending, and receiving system specifications to each other and with the standards they claim to support may often be required. This is especially true for HL7 version 2 interfaces. If some of the interoperability capabilities are already in production, then looking at the live capability on that system would be helpful. For example, studying actual messages from a live feed or sending test calls to an actual FHIR server. In doing these comparisons, there is often mapping work that must be done between systems. This is when you try to match outputs to inputs. Types of mapping include mapping the interoperability functions of one system to another, mapping the workflows of the entities, for example, departments, organizations, etc., being connected, determining what trigger events or calls are relevant, and mapping each data field, data type, and terminology. Let's look at an example. In our example scenario, Good Health Clinic wants notifications whenever one of their clinic patients is admitted or discharged from Caring Central Hospital to help them coordinate care for their patients. This allows the patient's primary care physician practicing at Good Health Clinic to better coordinate their patient's care by being notified of their patient's admission and subsequent discharge. To implement a solution, an interface sending admit and discharge messages for Good Health Clinic patients from the hospital system to the clinic system is being considered. Note that Good Health Clinic only wants information about their patients. In this example, the hospital patient management system probably already has an outbound HL7 version 2 patient administration ADT interface, which sends notifications of all hospital admissions. Since the clinic only wants hospital admit notifications about their patients, a filter might be needed. The specifications between the hospital and clinic systems must be compared. For HL7 version 2 interfaces, that starts with comparing trigger events and message types. In this example, Caring Hospital System supports A01 admit, A02 transfer, A12 cancel transfer, A11 cancel admit, A03 discharge, and Z01 admit pediatric. Good Health Clinic supports A01 admit and A03 discharge. Are there any incompatibilities? The first thing to note is that the sending events A02, A12, A11, and Z01 are not expected on the receiving system of Good Health Clinic. This is a significant gap. Perhaps the events from the sending system will be able to be mapped into two Good Health Clinic trigger events. The second thing to note is that the sender is using a Z segment. That means that site-specific work will be needed since there is no logical map. Drilling down into the details further, all of the interoperability objects of the sender and receiver need to be compared, and all of the differences need to be identified. These differences will need to be addressed. Listed here are some examples of potential differences. Let's look at another interoperability project example. Good Health Clinic also wants to receive a patient visit summary whenever one of their patients is discharged from Caring Central Hospital and transitioned to the clinic for follow-up care. Because of meaningful use and ONC 2014 certification of systems, each system has the capability to send and receive HL7 CCDA documents. However, HL7 CCDA documents have differences between them. Each vendor builds them a little differently, and provider implementation may also vary. Imagine if the patient care summary was a CCDA document. Some examples of data incompatibilities could be that different codes were used to represent glucose. The receiver was expecting both codes and the description of the codes, but only received the codes. The receiver got more data than expected or desired, or the receiver did not get structured medication data as expected since it is part of the standard. What other possibilities could you think of? An important part of examining an interoperability problem is to understand the current state's workflow. Since we are talking about interoperability, there are often multiple workflows involved. Diagramming workflows is especially helpful because it can be done in collaboration with the users. Interview the users and ask for walkthroughs so you can understand the process. The idea of the diagram is to unearth the complexities and time duration of processes with the goal of finding a shorter, less complex process. For example, a hospital has an EHR, but does not have an electronic orders interface with the Laboratory Information System, or LIS. Therefore, the orders are printed and sent to the lab with the specimen. There are manual processes involved in both the specimen collection as well as in the check-in or accession process in the lab. The steps are as follows. Doctor's orders printed from EHR. A nurse collects specimen and labels it with the patient's name, patient ID, and visit ID. The nurse packages the specimen with the printed order and sends it to the lab. The lab clerk receives the specimen, searches for the patient on the LIS, creates order for the patient on the LIS, checks the specimen in, and writes the accession number on the label. The specimen is ready for actual lab result processing. As you review the current workflow with the users and consider an electronic orders interface, it becomes clear that some manual work is still required. The specimen still needs to be collected, labeled, sent, matched, and received. Ideally, the paper order should be eliminated. However, without the paper order, how will the lab intake clerk know which order to associate the specimen with? In the analysis phase, these concerns are noted as possible gaps to be resolved at design time. It is impossible for a healthcare interoperability standard to address every interoperability problem. Therefore, standards development organizations have been given the ability to extend the standards, which means a formal way of making an exception to the standard. HL7 version 2 has Z segments, and HL7 CDA and FHIR have extensions. Terminologies also have ways of extending their standards. While it is good that this capability exists in standards, using these capabilities should be avoided whenever possible, since they lead to lower interoperability. It is especially important not to use an exception when the standard already supports what is needed. For example, one mistake is when a V2 interface includes a Z segment for a patient's employer. At first glance, it may appear that HL7 version 2 does not support patient-employer information. However, that is not correct. It is already covered by the NK1 segment, which covers any associated party to the patient. Vendors should be experts on the standards they are implementing and should ask the standards organizations when they have questions. Features of robust system interoperability capabilities include: can send and receive all information, is compliant with most recent version of standards, has detailed specifications, is easy for provider to customize, has been field tested with other vendors, was not developed in a vacuum, has robust technical architecture, and has support capabilities such as alerts, monitors, error logging, and recycle. Vendors that develop robust interoperability solutions often have these qualities: is knowledgeable and active in the standards organizations for the standards they implement, participate in connectathons, obtain certifications, provide production support, and provide interface downtime workarounds. The results of the analysis phase is a much more in-depth understanding of the problem and its scope. Estimates are refined. All of this is recorded in a detailed document of requirements. There is even the possibility that you might have uncovered potential and/or major issues. You may find hidden complexities and extra requirements not initially anticipated. An outcome of the analysis phase is a fully articulated problem for which now you design a solution. This concludes Lecture B of Implementing Health Interoperability. To summarize, the analysis phase involves clarification of the problem, requirements gatherings, and gap analysis. Serious problems might be discovered at this step that may lead to project scope or scheduling changes. The main outcome of the analysis phase is a detailed specification of the problem so that a solution can now be designed.